Buser, and I am a financial advisor and owner of a financial consultancy business in Lake Oswego. Back in 2005, Westland held these tourism meetings. So Clackamas County was providing tourism grants for projects. And there was a woman there, a delightful woman, Fran Soder, who was 87 years old. And she had a news clipping, and she read this news clipping about something really important that happened in Westland. And she read a story about this large meteorite that floated in and this cataclysmic flooding. It was very dramatic. And she kind of reminded the community that we had something, a story to tell that would attract and bring visitors to the area. So we started this Willamette Meteorite Project, which was to try and create a replica and tell the story in Willamette, the historic town in Westland. And I don't know how I heard, but someone said, you know, there's an organization called the Ice Age Floods Institute. And so I got a hold of the president, and it was a small fledgling nonprofit organization that was trying to pass legislation for the Ice Age Floods National Geologic Trail. And so we decided that we would just merge this kind of Willamette Meteorite Project, this idea, into what the Institute was doing to attract larger partners and obviously to help bring in more resources to complete that project. The presentation is The Pearl of the Ice Age Floods. And when the legislation passed, and there's been a management plan that has been created, and there was always this language of the trail was a necklace of pearls, and that each pearl was a very unique feature, like dry falls in eastern Washington, a very dramatic dry waterfall and a representation of a flood feature. And so a pearl is an irritant and an oyster, and it just kind of fits, because the Willamette Meteorite, you know, was on an iceberg, literally, and floated 450 miles from the panhandle of Idaho, and was beached. You know, they found it just a few miles from here in Tualatin Hills. So it's a very fun story. I think that it's important to talk about the legislation and talk about the communities right now that are involved in building out some of the interpretive sites. In general, though, it's a very colorful story about the Willamette Meteorite and its journey. Well, first of all, I want to acknowledge a few people that are here that have played an incredibly important role in bringing this story to Oregon. Yvonne Addington, Charles had already mentioned a few things. I could say more. I could go on and on. Every time I'm with Yvonne, I learn something new about her. She reminds me of me, because she's a champion. She gets a hold of a cause, and like a bulldog, will not let it go. So she was the right person for me to hand this project off to. I did it for 9 years. I kind of retired from it to build a business, and I'm so fortunate to come back and talk about a subject that's very near and dear to my heart. Okay, so scientists are still debating exactly when these floods occurred. As you can see, there's a footprint in gray of the pathway of the Ice Age Floods, also known as the Missoula Floods, and also as the Spokane Floods. Although most people use the term Missoula Floods, scientists, when they're talking about this event. But they do agree that the floods occurred 12,000 to 15,000 years ago. There were multiple floods, so that's another debate, is how many. Some will say 20, some 40. So you can estimate 30, 40 of these separate flooding events that happened roughly every 80 to 90 years. The floods would repeat and reoccur over a 3,000 year period. So one of the things I love about geology is it makes me realize how insignificant my life is. This is back. So there was an ice age, of course. It was the most recent ice age that we've had that caused ice a half a mile high to encroach, creep south across Canada and down into the United States. Some people think that the Willamette Valley was formed by a glacier, but we can clearly see that it wasn't with this map. So before we get to the story of the Willamette Meteorite, of this pearl of the Ice Age flood, I have to teach you a little bit about the Missoula Flats. So we are going to do a flyover, literally, of some of the features and the flows and the landforms that we talk about when we talk about these kind of pearls on the necklace of this quad state or four state area. It all started right here at the ice dam. There's lobes, that's what they would give names. So you've got the Okanagan lobe, and the lobe where the ice dam was called the Purcell lobe. And literally, these glaciers, like fingers, just flowed into the mountainous valleys of northern Idaho, blocking the Clark Fork River. And this was a major drainage for the Western Canadian Rockies into the Columbia River Gorge, and then emptied all that water out to sea. So that caused a massive ancient lake to have formed where Missoula, Montana is. Lake Pend'Oreille is simply there was a depression or an impression that was made by the ice on top of the landform that it created a basin, which currently we know today as Lake Pend'Oreille. So we're talking about very large areas. One of the hardest things for me when I learned this story was really to get my mind wrapped around how big this was. That was always hard for me. I was always the guy telling it, now tell me again, how high was the water here? You know, it's just, the scale is incredible. And I think that's why people are so fascinated by this story, is the scale. The ice dam would fail. That was the trigger of the floods. The lake was at about 4,000 feet elevation, and then you're talking 0 feet elevation at the ocean. So you had, everything was perfect. You had a giant lake that was being blocked by a half mile tall ice dam. You had the elevation gradient that would have caused these floods to splash almost like water out of a bathtub and inundate the land. So this was a lake with 530 cubic miles of water. So you got to kind of think about that, a mile by mile by mile cube filled with water, and there were 500 cubic miles of water behind the ice dam. Recent theories, which I think is kind of neat, is that they think that there was super cooled water at the base of the ice dam, and that it acted like a drill bit would, kind of drilling through concrete. And there were these micro holes that started to form, and the holes started to get a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger, and then it collapsed in upon itself. And as I said, every 80 to 90 years, it would reform. They do know that the largest floods were the first floods. And as the ice age, as there was warming and the ice age began to retreat, and as the ice dam began to form, it was never as large as the previous ice dam. In fact, most of the floods probably didn't get to the Willamette Valley. If there were 40, maybe it was just 6 or 7 of the first ones that got all the way to the Willamette Valley.
I have a question. Is that okay?
Yes, questions are great.
You said earlier that the Willamette Valley, according to this map, obviously wasn't created by a glacier. Mm-hmm. So are you saying that it was the flooding that created the Willamette Valley? Is that?
Not quite. In fact, the floods, the floods did not create anything.
Uh-huh.
The floods made a dramatic impact on existing landforms. So the Willamette Valley was really just a, from what I understand, pretty rocky, you know, from basalt, you know, a lot of just brush. And what the floods did is the floods brought in the loess, which is the glacial soils that are right around the Palouse area. Palouse is in eastern Washington. It's beautiful. So beautiful hills with wheat being grown on them. Well, the floods picked up much of that soil from eastern Washington, and as it back flooded down to Eugene, so as the floodwaters filled the Willamette Valley, then that water, it settled, and it kind of acted like a settling pond, and all that soil dropped out. So roughly, I believe it's 5 cubic miles of soil that was brought to the Willamette Valley, which really explains the fertility of the abundance of our agriculture.
Yeah. But you say that it brought all of that soil and all that enrichment into the Willamette Valley. It was already a valley there.
Correct.
Right. So, but could that valley previously have been glacier created?
You'd have to talk to a glacial scientist on that, so I'm not sure about that. Okay. So this was a feature. It's a feature you can see today, especially when there's a light dusting of snow. Missoula, Montana is right. You can see it on the valley floor. And above on the hills, you can see the scars that are etched into that hillside. This is one of the pieces of evidence that there was more than one flood. This suggests that this lake had many different levels, which meant that, again, larger floods in the beginning and smaller floods, smaller lakes throughout that period of time of the cataclysm. So this is Camas Prairie. I wanted to tell you all a story because it was really just one of the neatest things that I've ever gotten to do. When the Ice Age floods, we'll talk a little bit about the legislation later, I'm going to reference it, but the law that was passed to establish the Ice Age Floods National Geologic Trail authorized the National Park Service to do a management plan of the park. So this is the planning of how is this thing going to be implemented across 4 states. And it culminated in a field trip all the way from Missoula, Montana. We followed the flood pathways all the way to the Pacific Ocean with USGS scientist Richard Wade, who's made some important discoveries himself about the floods. There was just a whole group of geologists, and I was just on for the ride. So this is one of the places we went, and you walk up close to it, you see large hills. They're about 40 feet high, and they're about 100 feet apart, 200 feet apart, and you don't see what they are when you're up close to them. Then you go up to a bluff and you look down on them and you see a landform that we all see when we go to the Oregon coast. So a surging tide perhaps. These are ripples. And these are gigantic ripples, which tells us, again, this informed scientist of flow rates. So flow rates have been calculated from these landforms. And there were some places, especially the constrictions like Crown Point and the Columbia Gorge, where the floodwaters were moving at the speed of the highway traffic that we see today. So it's massive flow rates of water across this area. This is as I was doing an interview earlier, and I was asked about the trail. And the reference is this necklace with these pearls of these really amazing features that were caused by the floods. This is beneath Grand Coulee. This is called Dry Falls. In fact, they call it Sun Lake State Park. And of course, I camped there because had to go see it. And it's an amazing feature. You can't find this anywhere in the world. And this is a dry waterfall, what they call a receding waterfall, like Niagara is. So it's a horseshoe type shape, but it just goes on and on and on. So this is a very impressive site. You can see where it formed, and it formed right against a ledge of the ice sheet off of that Okanagan lobe. So where there were narrow places for the water to go, that was where it was more vigorous, and that is where it did much more of its damage. This is Drumheller Channel. This is classic scab land. I wanted to put this picture here because while you're out hiking in the Columbia Gorge or even Camisea Park in West Lynn, the bluff in Oregon City, you can see this kind of rocky, kind of barren landscape. So you know that this is a place where the floods, this is one of the pathways. And the scablands also indicate that the water was very vigorous in that area. So, you know, floodwaters either deposited sediment and rock when it was still, or it was gouging out and and throwing rocks around. So, Bridgeport Village is on a big pile of Missoula flood rock. Lake Oswego was a fault. There's different theories. I'm not sure what the latest one is, but I've heard scientists say that the Tualatin River actually flowed where Lake Oswego is. And when the floods occurred and dumped all the sediment and silt on the east end of the lake, that river had to find a new path. So now it runs through West Lynn. So a lot of the places we drive by every day are floods features. Tualatin, you see the big kind of the wetlands and the holes, and that's all that is flood features. And so this is a familiar site. This is Crown Point. The floodwaters actually breached the ledge there. This is one of many constrictions that were in the route of the floods. And a constriction works like a fire hose in that as water is, as that volume is reduced, then the velocity and the flow rate is much higher. So it's almost like a fire hose coming out of the gorge here and spreading throughout the Portland and Willamette Valley area. So it all started with this map. This map took J. Harlan Bretz, who was the author of this kind of shocking hypothesis to the geologic community that cataclysm was one of the forces that helped shape the world. Geology was just becoming a hard science, accepted as one of the sciences. And then here's a guy that comes and says that there was a cataclysmic flood, which went against uniformitarianism, which had been helpful to the geologic community. So there's a lot of conflict that went on, as there is when anyone comes up with some preposterous idea and challenges us. There's many that will try and belittle and a lot of ego involved. But J. Harlan Bretz, who was a biology teacher, a high school biology teacher in Seattle, he also taught at the University of Washington. He taught at the University of Chicago. While he was there, he would take a cadre of his students. They'd set up a camp. It must have been really fun and crazy. So there's crazy pictures of these encampments. They would spend 3 months traversing the scablands. This is a 13,000 square kilometer area that was the initial area of study. And J. Harlan Bretz didn't know where the water came from, and he didn't care, is what we're told, that he just was sure that there had been cataclysmic floods that occurred in this particular area. So the map is extremely accurate. If satellite images, it's amazing. And he had a compass, I assume. He He did have a car, I know that, yeah. And he had a bunch of students that I'm sure were volunteering and not getting paid for their work, but happy to do it. He's a colorful character, and you know, his interest was peaked in 1910. They were just starting to come out with topographical maps. There was a topographic map that he got of a place called Potholes Coulee, and it was a dry waterfall. And when you looked at the topography, it was really clear that it was a dry waterfall, and that's what piqued his interest, and that's what got him really devoted his entire life to proving that this was the large floods, these cataclysmic floods. I talked about Richard Waite and his contribution. This is the evidence that he turned up to confirm that there was more than one flood, but perhaps 30 to 40 floods. Interestingly enough, just looking at it, someone would think, well, yeah, this looks like these are different layers, and these are different floods, and these are separate deposits. But what the real smoking gun was, he found Mount St. Helens ash and could date it to, I want to say, 13,000 years ago, 13 to 14,000 years ago during an eruption. And by finding that layer of silt between those layers, it confirmed that indeed the floods did occur over that time period and that there were multiple flooding events. So I want to talk a little bit about the Ice Age Floods Institute. I'd like to acknowledge Rick Thompson. He's the president. He's in the back. Wave, Rick. And the Ice Age Floods Institute is an organization I was involved with. As Charles talked about, we started a chapter here locally. The Institute it educates the public about the Ice Age Floods. It's an educational 501c3 nonprofit. And you can see some of the things they do, lectures. The field trips are very popular. I encourage you to go to the website, www.iafi.org, to look at the different, all the schedule of events. It's all across the four states. There's always something really neat going on. Great people, some people, the mountain bikes. That's one of the attractive features of making this a unit of the National Park Service, is that you can see it by boat, you can see it by bike, you can see it by airplane. There's so many different ways to view the floods. There's projects that are being done. When the legislation passed, there was no money, as there is not money anymore for National Park Service projects. They rely now on local communities getting behind projects. They want to be the brand of it, but they want it to be built by local communities, which I think will make a stronger and better trail, because communities know their area better than the federal government. So here's a chapter that they put a kiosk in here on Badger Mountain. This is an erratic that you can see here that they've painted and marked, and kind of shows the high water level. Other projects that are going on. This is a picture of Rep. Doc Hastings from Eastern Washington and Senator Maria Cantwell, who were sponsors of the legislation. So Maria Cantwell was the Senate sponsor, and Doc Hastings was the House sponsor. The formation of the Institute was really a kind of the behest of them. They said, look, we introduced this legislation, now you've got to get people excited about it. We need to hear from our constituents that this is important. And so the Ice Age Floods Institute started out as a Friends of the Ice Age Floods National Geologic Trail, and then has since evolved into the authority on the Ice Age Floods now. This is something Washington State Parks did. This was prior to the passage of the bill. They really wanted to invest money in the flood features here in Washington. So there was about, I think, six different sites where they have put interpretive panels in to tell the story of the floods. This is the park. Yes, that's my mother-in-law, my son, a long time ago. This is what the project that we completed in West Lynn through grants from Clackamas County and through fundraising by selling little mini meteorites. And so this is in Fieldsbridge Park, so I'm going to go through the story, but if you're interested in spending a little bit more time, I'm going to skip over things. Definitely visit Fieldsbridge Park just outside of Willamette, and this trail is cut in along the river. There's three different kiosks. There's a replica of the Willamette Meteorite, and we brought in three, you know, one of those rocks is 160 tons, and it was, again, like the meteorite, floated in on a glacier, and the glacier grounded, and that's how that rock got there. Those three rocks I stole from Tualatin, didn't I? I found them, and I didn't tell anybody.
Thank you.
You're your own. Tualatin, you know, it's just amazing to me that when I was ready to kind of get out of this and focus on some other priorities I had, I asked Yvonne to take my place and to carry the torch, and she carried such a bright torch. Tualatin has attracted a lot of attention, a lot of money to build out here. I think that there's a vision here as that ice age and the flora, the fauna, you know, even the early peoples, that could be a tourist draw. It could make Tualatin into a very unique place to visit. The Ice Age Floods National Geologic Trail Act was passed, and the management plan has Tualatin on the trail. So you would see in the future brown signs, a logo, probably a big wave, and a mastodon floating on his back. I don't know. I don't know what the logo is going to be. But it will bring people into these communities that are interested in learning this story.
Mark, Paul Hannon, the city of Fallen, who's done the trail, is back boom there. He needs to be
acknowledged. Paul? There he is. Paul's been another champion, our city champion,
yes.
Someone who's gotten behind this and supported the nonprofit. Thank you, Yvonne, for letting me know that he was here tonight. So this is one of the paintings that was commissioned for the interpretive trail at Fieldsbridge Park of the meteorite, as Charles said, several million, hundreds of million, who knows. Meteorites were formed, they think, 3 to 5 billion years ago. These are remnants from the formation of our universe. And the one thing they can tell, actually, but that's interesting, it's like a pool. If you were playing pool and you hit one ball and that ball ricocheted off another ball and changed that trajectory, well, they see that there was a reheating and a recrystallization of the molecules of iron. It's an iron nickel meteorite, which indicated that it was actually impacted, heated up, recrystallized, and so serendipitously sent on a path toward West Lynn, where I would eventually live. this is the other piece of art that we had commissioned. You know, Stevo Minsky has a very unique talent, the ability to illustrate, I think, in a very accurate way. He was very specific about the science behind each piece. He spent a lot of time talking to different scientists and getting their perspectives, and he took that information and made these illustrations. So the meteorite, yeah, this is really, it was kind of a coincidence. It was strange. I went to the site once. So because I was, I guess, you know, we were doing this meteorite project and the people were very private, but we were allowed on the land. So we went up there with a bunch of Boy Scouts and magnets, and we were dragging magnets around, and the magnets are picking up pieces of rust. So you can actually, you know, they still haven't pulled all the rust out of the hole. So my son says, "Hey, Dad, you gotta." He was going to band practice, and he wanted me to pick up his friend, who was, I guess, their bass player. And so I drive into, and I'm like, "God, this looks exactly like my Willamette Meteorite was where we came." Sure enough, I pull up his driveway, and I'm like, "This is it. This is where the meteorite was found." And so, of course, I wanted to say something, and ask my son, like, "Don't say anything about it. I don't want you to ask him." I'm like, "Okay, you ask him later, you know."
15-year-olds embarrassed. Who knows what their reasons are, but anyway, I didn't confirm it. So here's what is believed to have happened. And when I was doing research on the meteorite, I come across a obscure article in an Oregon geology magazine. And the article was co-authored by Dick Pugh. He is with the Cascadia Meteorite Laboratory at Portland State University, and he was a science teacher from Cleveland High School that was retired. And they hypothesized, they were the first to hypothesize, that the Willamette Meteorite came in on an iceberg. And to try and give you some idea of where this is, because again, I don't recognize it, but this is the Tualatin River channel. So it's that channel that's about 3/4 mile wide in Westland. 205 runs right through it. And you can see that the mouth of the Tualatin, so at Willamette Park in Westland, and that's where the mouth of the Tualatin feeds into the Willamette River. So if you can imagine, you have a large flow of water exiting into the Willamette Valley, and that creates a eddy. In fact, all across the floodscape, you'll see where there were eddies. And the eddies, you can figure out, you actually can identify them because of the sediments that are deposited, because you've got this water going around in a circle and depositing sediments. And you can also figure out the direction based on the elevation of the formation. So imagine the meteorite coming down that main channel on iceberg and then kind of backing up and becoming caught in the eddy. And what's interesting is that we used a map that shows what that water line, what that shoreline would have been, about 380 feet above the Tualatin River. And you can see the red dot as the meteorite. And that is where it would ground, right? That's kind of this little peninsula that's sticking out that would have caught it. This is all circumstantial evidence. And this was one of the things that I loved about this project, was I felt like, you know, we were forging new ground. We were, you know, making our own new discoveries in our own backyard. So it was a joy. And so that's where the meteorite grounded. That's how we think that happened. So the first people to have encountered the Willamette meteorite were the Clackamas Indians. And you know, they were all over Westland. They had little hunting trails, and they had happened upon the Willamette meteorite. This all came out of court testimony later. So these stories occurred in the 1970s, I think, is when there was attempts at reclaiming the meteorite. There was actually two attempts. One, of course, was in the 1920s, right? And then again, there was an appeal, so there was a court case, because the meteorite was found on the property of Oregon Iron and Steel. And there was a lumberman there, and let's shoot to that next picture. But before I move to the story of how Ellis Hughes found the meteorite, I do want to point out that the Clackamas Indians, their legends were dipping their arrows. So the Willamette meteorite has a very rough face. There's a lot of holes in it. It looks like Swiss cheese, kind of. And the way that happened was, the meteorite wasn't like that when it landed, but after sitting on a hillside and, you know, with bird poop and leaves and organic material, would react with the iron nickel and created a carbonic acid that actually etched and cut those holes out. So the story is that the Native Americans dipped their arrows in for power. They used the waters for healing that were formed inside of the hollows of the meteorite. And then in 1902, Ellis Hughes, he was a lumberman living in the Westland area. Looks like he was, he owned a tool shop, so he sharpened saws, I believe, was mainly his business. He was not he was kind of he was a little rough around the edges. There's archived letters and archived citations and grocery bills that were unpaid, and so So there's a sense that he was pretty rough around the edges. Well, him and his friend Dale, Dale was out visiting. He was a miner. He was in the mining industry. I think it was his uncle, actually. And Ellis Hughes stopped on his way. They were on their trail going, trekking from his house to some area where they were cutting timber. And he sits down, and kind of Dale looks at him and says, "What's that, Ellis?" And he says, "I don't know." And so Dale kind of looks around. He picks up a white rock about the size of a basketball. And that's an important part of the story because there's a lot of granite that was found here in Willamette. And the only way granite gets here is if it floats in an iceberg, because there is no native granite to this side of Oregon. And they can even say that granite came from Idaho or came from that mountain range. And so apparently he had picked up an erratic. He had picked up a piece of granite and he hit it and it rang like a bell. And he said, "You have a meteorite here, Ellis." So ever the enterprising young man, he decided that he was going to try and make a buck off of the Willamette meteorite. So it was not on his property, but it was about 3/4 of a mile away. And he built this sled, you can see, kind of a Flintstone sled. And let me see, if you look at the top left picture, this was the mechanism, this is how he did it. So he had to drag this thing down a mountain through a forested area, and he used a Spanish windlass, and he attached it to that cart. So if you go back there, so he attached that cart, and horses would turn the turnstile on that windlass, and they would move it, sometimes a foot in one day, because of course it was the rainy season. and so he ended up finally getting it over to his property, and you can imagine that when it got to his property, he had cut a road, literally, from the property of Oregon Iron and Steel to his house. Oregon Iron and Steel caught wind, and to them, they saw a large iron deposit that they could melt down and make a lot of money off of. And so they sued Ellis Hughes to regain possession of the meteorite, and the arguments came down to if something, his argument was that this rock came from the heavens, and it just landed here. And so it's not your property, it's the property, So it was a property argument of whose it was. And that's how the Native Americans came in and got involved. The Clackamas peoples said, "No, we own it, because we were the first ones, it was on our land." So there was a long battle, protracted battle in court, and Ellis Hughes lost, and he appealed. With the Native American, with the chief. Chief Ed Joseph, or I think was his name, and he came and testified and sat on the witness stand and said that these are the stories that were passed down. Ellis Hughes, so, lost the appeal, and it was right during the Lewis and Clark Exposition of 1906. So then what happened is the meteorite was going to be unveiled at Oregon Iron and Steel had it back, but it was going to be unveiled at the Lewis and Clark Exposition at the World's Fair. And so you can see it here getting pulled from Ellis Hughes' property. This is right along Blankenship Road, where Blankenship Road is now in West Lynn. And it's getting ready for transport. And you can see here it being transported through Portland to the World's Fair, to the site, the exposition site. Well, the iris of the Dodge Phelps fortune happened to be, had heard about the meteorite, had traveled here from New York, went to the exposition, and promptly bought it from Oregon Iron and Steel, which is a blessing because I believe Oregon Iron and Steel, their plan was to cut it up and cut it to pieces and melt it down. And she donated it to the American Museum of Natural History in New York. Interestingly enough, one of those wheels, the back right wheel is cut right through the concrete road, and it's created a rut for me. So the meteorite, it was immense. I don't think I told you how much it weighed, and that's important. It was 16 tons. about the size of a VW bus. So has anyone been to New York and seen this, seen the meteorite? Yes. Yeah, so it's about 13 feet from the bottom to the top. It's got a 4.5 foot depth. It's extremely rare. It's the sixth largest meteorite that's ever been found in the world to this day. So there it is. Please visit this park. One of the reasons we did this park was really to invite our partners. So we brought Metro out to take a look at it, and Metro has recently set aside money to buy, I think it's a 5-acre property with a cult pond. They're already working on a management plan to build the Tonkin Ice Age Trail, thanks to Yvonne and my work to make sure that they put Ice Age in the name of that trail that's going to cross those features. And so people would come see this, and it really, I think, sparked the imagination and put the idea in people's head that Oregon can be, we're on the map, we're on the trail, we want to be on the trail. We really do, because it's something very unique, and we like to be unique here in Portland. Thank you very much for your time.